I'm Caroline, a yoga teacher with a particular interest in menopause based in Edinburgh.
And hi, I'm Dr. Claire, a GP with a special interest in menopause based in North London.
Together we are the Menopause Sisters and we are here to guide and support you through your menopause journey. Hello.
Hi there, how are you? How has your week been?
It's Saturday afternoon for the listeners listening to this particular episode and I was out last night. Ooh. Nothing extravagant, out with somebody for dinner. I'm paying for it today. I had two glasses of wine. I know wine is one of my triggers for my muscle ache and joint pain. And so I generally don't drink, but I thought actually it'd be really nice to have a glass of wine. We had two glasses of wine each, and I'm still paying for it at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So it just means my muscle ache and joint pain is still very sore. But I know sugar and alcohol is, you know, that's what makes it worse for me. So there's that kind of trade-off.
Yeah.
I think as well. So yeah, just a bit annoying, but you know, it was worth it last night. It was nice. How about you?
Yeah, busy week. Did some menopause training for some GP trainees last week, which was good, which was interesting. And actually it does just remind me that although the menopause and the perimenopause are being talked about more and more, there's still a lack of knowledge out there amongst many health professionals, let alone many women. So it still alarms me. It's still kind of, but it's good because it just means that, you know, we can, doing these teaching sessions with GP trainees and registrars is really important because it's another thing that they need to know that is going to affect 50% of the population. So I always say to them, you know, it's the one thing that's going to benefit most of your patients is knowing about this. So that was what I did. Spent a lot of time teaching this week and doing the just general crazy week with children and ferrying them around. And actually what I did do last week was I did a lovely workshop with Petra Coveney, menopause yoga down in North London, which was lovely, in a lovely yoga studio called Down to Earth. And that was really nice because, again, it was a face-to-face workshop where we could incorporate Eastern and Western medicine and kind of learn from one another and not be frightened of embracing each other's opinions about how to manage the menopause. So that was really great because I think, again, it just enabled us to talk through what the menopause is and how we might help ourselves.
Oh no, that sounds great. I remember you talking about that actually, and Petra had been in touch to say it was just it was funny because our mannerisms apparently are very similar. And she said it was really funny working with your sister because obviously I've worked with Petra quite a lot as well, so that made me laugh as well. I'd forgotten yesterday actually delivered a session for Edinburgh Council, which was brilliant. They do these wonderful sort of health and wellbeing weeks, or perhaps they're fortnights, I can't remember. And they gather together different professionals to be able to deliver sessions, short sessions, 45 minutes, an hour on whatever it might be, and to support their staff. And staff can just sign up to whichever session they would like to do, and it's all done online, so again really really great. So you just on Teams, and we had I think about 45 women had signed up for the session I was delivering on menopause and yoga for to support menopause. And it was interesting actually because while we were waiting for everybody to arrive, a couple of questions that women were asking and just saying, could you maybe answer this? And actually one of the questions that came up was there was a woman struggling with quite a few symptoms still. She's postmenopausal and she said, can you just tell me when this ends? Mm. And it was just really interesting because by then there were quite a few women in the Teams virtual room. Mm. And I said, well, let's just briefly talk about the fact the menopause is just the one day after, you know, you've not had a period for 12 months. There's that little bit before the perimenopause, which could be 2, 6, 10 years. And then you've got the postmenopause part, which is where you're at. And it, you know, for some women, they breeze through it. For some women, you know, there's a little bit of a struggle with certain symptoms. And for some women, symptoms go on. And I said to, you know, go and speak to a healthcare professional, ideally your GP. And she had asked, you know, how do I get referred to a specialist? And I said, Well, actually, you shouldn't need to be referred to a specialist. You should be able to go and see a GP, and you just need to look out for somebody who has a particular interest in menopause or post-reproductive health. So,
And actually, that's a really interesting point, isn't it? Is that the number of appointments that we could save in secondary care for those women that don't need to be seen in a secondary care setting? They could just be seen for a few appointments in their GP with their GP, and actually they wouldn't have to wait months and months to be seen in a specialist setting, unless, of course, you've got a more complicated medical history, in which case that's absolutely the right place to be seen. But for the majority of women, actually, the menopause in terms of management is very straightforward.
Yeah, and actually I was encouraging her just to have initial chat with the GP and just talk about different options because, yes, HRT may help, but there are other things that she can do, like the yoga that she was joining in with yesterday. And yeah, and I think she found that really helpful. I think she just thought, well, when's it going to stop? And I said, well, at the moment, it might not initially. You might just have some symptoms. Many symptoms for women do go on. So it's just talking about what the symptoms are and perhaps speaking to somebody about them and working out what could possibly help alleviate them for you.
Yeah, and I think that's what we decided to do today, isn't it? It's to come together and just maybe go through a few Q&As, because we've had a lot recently, haven't we? There's been a lot on social media with particular specific questions, and whilst we can't love to answer them all, whilst we can't answer them all, there are some generic questions that we can group together and perhaps think about answering more generally.
Yeah, and actually, it was one from I've got Aileen here, and we touched on this last week actually with Emily, but she'd said, why is it we, and we being women, have to fight so hard to be taken seriously when we ask for help? And why do we have to wait till 45 or 46? And you were talking about that earlier, you've just been doing some training this week with GPs and registrars. And actually, I guess it starts with medical schools, trying to make sure medical schools have got it on their curriculum. And
I mean, you could dig into that so deeply, couldn't you? Yes, it's all about education and getting health professionals and women really, really well educated. But actually, for quite a long time, I think that women's health has generally been relatively neglected, and you could argue all sorts of reasons why that is, which we're not going to get into today. But yeah, I guess the main thing is it starts with us all being educated, whether or not we're health professionals or other, so that we can actually just be, forearmed, and think about what potential treatments there are. And yes, it's still really surprising that many women think that their periods have to have stopped or changed before they can start treatment, or before that they can be classed as perimenopausal. And that's, I guess, one of the first myths that we'd like to bust, is that you can still be having reasonably regular cycles, or indeed regular cycles, and be perimenopausal. You've just got to be looking out for all symptoms of the menopause, not just one or two, because those one or two that are very, very common might not be your symptom.
yeah, and that goes back to it being an individualized care, isn't it? You're looking after each individual woman in a slightly different way from a doctor or GP's point of view. And you mentioned education of, sort of healthcare professionals. I've often said sometimes it's the nurse in a surgery that's the specialist and really knows where to point you and how to help. But also this also go back to I go back to schools as well, and going back to so I guess what they used to call sex education, which talks about puberty, talks about periods, talks about the biology of having a baby, all of the above, and actually just popping it in there and saying and explaining to everyone that actually there's something that happens at the other end. Your hormones fluctuate again, and you're going to get quite a few similar symptoms potentially as you do in puberty, but there are others that will arise. And yeah, that's something just to have in the back of your mind, so you're aware of what's likely to happen often or in the majority sort of post 40, but it could happen earlier. We've got a few more questions, and this one's from Ailsa. Her male GP, I quite like that she put male in there. I think that was just a bit of a dig, but anyway, I'm reading it as it was written. Her male GP said she could only be on HRT for a short while due to the risk of breast cancer. What are the actual facts? So I'm going to hand you over to this one, Claire. I think you'll
So I would say that, oh, where to start with this one? It feels like I'm constantly trying to dispel this myth that HRT doesn't cause breast cancer. So if you're under 51, HRT is only actually naturally replacing the hormones you would have had there anyway. So under the age of 51, there's not thought to be any extra risk of breast cancer. Over the age of 51, perhaps a very slight increase, but again, that increase is so small, it's relatively insignificant. It's more significant to think about breast cancer in relation to your lifestyle. So you're more likely to get breast cancer if you have a couple of glasses of wine a day, if you're overweight, or if you don't look after your lifestyle well enough. And that is probably more significant than taking HRT is. The other fact to remember is that causation doesn't equal correlation. So there are many factors that cause breast cancer. Taking HRT is not necessarily directly linked, and certainly isn't directly linked to breast cancer, but there are many factors. So, like we said, lifestyle, diet, environmental, social factors. If you were born in the UK after 1960 as a woman, you've got about a 1 in 6 to 1 in 7 chance of getting breast cancer in your lifetime. We're living longer. As we age, we're more likely for our bodies to go wrong. Cell changes happen, so we're more likely to get breast cancer. Taking HRT doesn't increase the risk of breast cancer, and actually, in many cases, estrogen-only HRT probably reduces your risk of breast cancer. So for years, there's been sort of scaremongering that estrogen is what we call a carcinogen, a cancer-causing chemical. And actually, we know that studies have shown that if you take estrogen, actually, you're probably less likely to get breast cancer than even if you take no HRT at all. Now, obviously, with HRT, you need both estrogen and progesterone. So we're talking about women who don't need the progesterone component of HRT, so they've had a hysterectomy, for example, so they don't need that progesterone component to protect the lining of the womb. But yeah, estrogen isn't a carcinogen, and so we've got to get away from this myth that HRT causes breast cancer. And certainly, the younger you are, there isn't a risk, and that's really important to get across.
And actually, I think it might be worth just mentioning to our listeners the course that is free for healthcare professionals to take. It's developed by 14 Fish and being paid for, I guess, or subsidised by the Menopause charity. And so that is something that all healthcare professionals can do for free to get some up-to-date menopause training, and all the stats are in there. And it covers everything, actually. There's a dermatologist in there as well, isn't there? And so it really does cover all the different elements. And I think it's just really important. This is going to keep coming up. It's just going to keep coming back, isn't it? It's going to keep coming round. And actually, until all healthcare professionals understand the facts as they are today, the up-to-date facts and statistics around taking HRT, we're going to still be answering this very similar question and kind of, I guess, debunking it again.
Yeah, I think that's the case. And unfortunately, it all stems from the Women's Health Initiative study many, many years ago, which for some reason I still don't know why is stuck and is stuck fast in many people's minds. And it's worth knowing that obviously this has been discredited, and also that this was a study done on older women who hadn't had HRT for a long time, but had also been given synthetic HRT, so synthetic estrogens and progesterones, which we know aren't very nice, and which we try on the whole to avoid now because we've got far better preparations, which we know are very safe. So the body identical preparations that we've spoken about in the past. So I really want us to move away from HRT being thought of as you know, a cancer-causing medication. It's not. It's safe. It's highly effective, and it's evidence-based and licensed, and actually the go-to for menopausal symptoms for women who are suffering from them in the UK. So we follow the NICE guidelines in the UK, and those are very strict guidance that we adhere to. And very clearly, in amongst the bulk of that document, it says that if you've got symptoms and you're menopausal, then HRT is what is licensed for you and will help most of the time.
It's interesting because it comes up even in my yoga classes. So on a Friday morning, I've got my yoga class for women in perimenopause and menopause. And actually, you know, many of the women that come, I had a lovely woman that popped in a couple of weeks ago, and she said, actually, it's just really nice to be in a space with women who understand that I might just want to lie down on my mat and not completely join in. One of the women that joined me on Friday, so Friday just gone, we were just chatting, and I have enough time in that. You know, it's a 90-minute class, but that leaves a little bit of time at the beginning for anyone who's running late, or there's just a little bit of chat and setting up, and also at the end, so there's that sense of community and connection with women. But what actually came up was, you know, so I definitely don't want to take HRT, and I said, I'm not going to pry, but you know, is there a particular reason? She said, well, you know, I really like natural remedies, and I said, that's great. And I described myself in a similar way. You know, you'll know, Claire, that my first point of call is a homeopathic remedy or a herbal remedy for a lot of what I may use for myself or the boys in the family. And when I said to her, well, actually, I'm on a really low dose of HRT, which I started 2 months ago, she was like, you are you're a yoga teacher. And I was like, yes. And I said, actually, you could think of it as being natural because it's derived from yams. So, you know, in lots of ways.
But it also is natural in itself, you know.
Exactly.
It's body identical. So, you know, we need to move away from it just being, oh, this is a natural product that's plant-based, and move towards, yes, it is all of those things, but it is very similar, almost identical to what you're producing otherwise. So we are naturally just replacing your own hormones in tiny, tiny doses. And what we've got to remember is that these doses are far lower than the combined pill or the progesterone pill. And we don't warn women that there's a high risk of breast cancer with those, and it's a high risk of side effects, and that they're just not very nice to take. But yet, for some reason, you know, you hear a GP, you hear of HRT, and immediately everyone says, oh, there's a risk of breast cancer with HRT. You can only take it until the age of 51. And if you've got a family history of breast cancer, you can't take it. All of those are not true. You know, if you have a family history, that's another question that often comes up. It depends what that family history is. And yes, that needs to be carefully looked at and discussed, and who that family history is with. But it doesn't prevent you from taking HRT. It just needs to be a shared decision-making tool that you use in order to make that decision for yourself. Because I do feel that if you've been given all the options, and you've been given and discussed all the risks with your health professional, then actually you shouldn't be told no. If you want to take HRT and you're aware of the risks and the side effects, which are incidentally very low, then you should be able to say, well, actually, that's the treatment I want.
Yeah, and it's actually having that discussion. And so it was really, really helpful for me to share that on Friday, because, you know, I don't shout about it, but I'm very happy to talk about it when people do ask, or, you know, and because it's really important, I think, to be able to share my personal experience of HRT, even though I'm very early on into it. And as you know, I've had to fight for the oestrogen part, the micronized progesterone, and actually had to pay a private GP this week for the privilege of getting it. And it was interesting talking to him, actually. He'd said he'd got my inquiry, and he said he was just quite surprised. He was like, yes, of course I'll see her if she just wants oestrogen. That's just a normal prescription. And I explained that in NHS Lothian, it's not a normal prescription because it's not on the formulary for NHS Lothian. So, you know, it,
About what you're doing, I mean, more about that, because obviously you're in Scotland and I'm in London, and it's very, for me, it's very easy to prescribe. But tell us about what your journey in terms of that so far.
yeah, well, I mean it's quite interesting. The Scottish Medicines Consortium, so the SMC, basically provide advice to NHS Scotland about the value of whatever licensed medicines, you know, the value that every patient, or for every patient, newly licensed medicines could give for that patient. And they decided, and actually this is back in 2009, that actually it just the evidence wasn't there. There were, as the evidence from the company was not strong enough, basically, to be certain that oestrogen, which is the micronized progesterone, so if you have a womb, if you know, if you still have your womb intact, you need the progesterone to protect the lining of the womb. And yeah, they just said no, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't warrant being licensed here. So it's quite interesting because I think it was actually up to the NHS boards, and I know there are GPs that do prescribe it across Scotland, but at the moment in NH Lothian, which is includes Edinburgh where I am, you can't get it. And I've had, I think I've said on previous show, I've got the most amazing GP, and she's been very honest with me. She said, Caroline, get yourself the private Eutrogestin if you can, let me know. And then on an NHS prescription, because NHS prescriptions are free in Scotland, I can give you the oestrogen gel. So that's currently what I'm doing. But I'm also just talking about it a little bit more and just shouting a little bit louder, because again, it comes back to me, you having a voice, having the knowledge, having the understanding, and using it. Because actually, for many women, it's another option, it's another choice. It's a safe option, micronized progesterone. And the only other option for me here would have been probably the coil or a patch, and I'd have chosen what I'd wanted the gel. So, but that comes back to us being involved in our individual care, doesn't it? And that discussion you can have with your GP.
And knowing your information. So, half of the battle, I think, in the menopause is obviously getting people to listen and understand your symptoms are real and significant. And then the other half is obviously, the self-education part, knowing what is going on for you and knowing what might help you. And obviously that's not quick and easy to work out. Takes some time. It takes kind of analysing your symptoms and thinking about what's going on. But actually, if you take the time to think about what's happening and what might help and do your research, you come to a point where actually you will have come across lots of issues. You will have come across lots of treatments, both pharmacological and non-pharmacological, and then you can make a decision with your GP rather than your GP making it for you, which.
It goes back to what Emily was sharing last week, actually, wasn't it? And about tracking, tracking your cycle. And, some women have always done that. Many women are like, gosh, I've never done that. I was one of those women. And it could be on a piece of paper, it could be on the back of a notepad, it could be on your phone. But just being able to perhaps align some of your symptoms to where you are in your cycle.
One of the other questions I had recently actually was, well, a woman who absolutely didn't want to take HRT, which is fine, fully informed decision making, decided it wasn't for her. What other options are there out there? And I thought maybe, Caroline, you could talk about sort of the lifestyle methods that could help. And then maybe I could sort of mention some of the other medications that are out there. But if you go for it in terms of lifestyle, what have you found has been really helpful?
Well, it's interesting that you got that question, because actually it's on our list. Actually, somebody else had got in contact about that. What other things can be helpful other than HRT? Obviously, being a yoga teacher, I'm going to say yoga straight away, but actually you'll find that many menopause specialists are recommending this now. I know yourself included, and Dr. Louise Newson. So, and what I like to maybe describe, and what I was describing actually to all the participants of Edinburgh Council session yesterday, was it's like a pair of jeans, yoga. It's got to fit, they've just got to fit just right. And that's the style of yoga, because there's so many different types of yoga, but as well the teacher. Because if you don't like the teacher's voice, or you just don't, for whatever reason, connect with the teacher, it's not going to work for you. But also the style. So, Ashtanga is a very strong style. Yeah, it just feels a little bit more like exercise, the sequence of it, or the physical part of that style of yoga. Hatha could be more gentle. I generally suggest, if you haven't done any yoga before, that you start perhaps with restorative yoga, because it's really lovely. You use a lot of different props to support yourself in a kind of restful shape. And actually, one of the big ways to alleviate the symptoms of perimenopause and postmenopause is to reduce stress, and that is connected to our autonomic nervous system. So, the rest and digest sides, the parasympathetic nervous system, but also the sympathetic nervous system is the other side. And sometimes that's described as flight and fright, but I like to remind people that actually we need to be in that side of the nervous system to also just get out of bed, to go for a walk, to go for a run, to do some activity. But it's making sure that your physical body, your nervous system, can come back into that rest and digest side quite easily, so that when your hormones are fluctuating, your body's going, oh, I'm stressed, I can't cope with this, then actually you've got maybe a breathing technique. And that's something that's a huge part of yoga, is breathing. And often people don't realize there's a massive part of a yoga practice is breathing. Yes, there is the movement, but there's also the meditation or visualization. Sometimes there's chanting. You might use mudra, hand gestures, to really help with energy. So there's many different styles of yoga, different elements of a yoga practice, but it might be the one particular one resonates. But breath work is a key one, and it's incredibly helpful.
We talk a lot about that, don't we, in our workshops, so how kind of breathing can be grounding, but also can help with, for example, hot flash symptoms, and to alleviate those problems of hot flashes.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And actually it just helps us calm our minds, begin to actually breathe properly as well. Because for many of us, we don't actually take a kind of a long, slow, deep breath as well. So it's, you know, just little things like that. I know in a future episode, we're going to be covering breath work anyway, so as a separate topic. So I think that's going to be really helpful. I mean, the obvious ones are if you're a smoker, trying to quit smoking, alcohol, reducing alcohol. Diet's a big one, isn't it? Diet's a big one as well.
I mean, I think it's really whenever I hear myself talking about lifestyle modifications, I always sort of have an internal personal heart sink moment, because I feel that, you know, if I'm saying this to a patient, they might be, oh, they're banging on about diet and lifestyle again, and oh, that's just, how's that going to help? But actually, honestly, hand on heart, these are things that tiny modifications in will super massively help. So really looking at every aspect of your life and tweaking it as much as you can is going to be helpful. So like Caroline said, you know, the yoga, but also look at your diet, look at what you're eating, look at what might be triggering symptoms. So Caroline, you mentioned alcohol for some, and it might be sugar.
Yeah, I mean, and actually alcohol is kind of a form of sugar. So I know, you know, I try not to have too many sweet things. And, you know, I've got a sweet tooth. I try not to have alcohol, you know, white carbohydrates. So that kind of, you know, the lovely white rolls, the refined carbohydrates, that's sugar. White pasta is sugar. And it's not saying give everything up, because that's just a nightmare. It's just becoming aware of what helps you and what doesn't help, I think, is really important. And staying hydrated, I mean, that's another thing that's really important. We often don't drink enough water, and that could be herbal teas, you know. Reducing caffeine, a lot of women find caffeine as a trigger, particularly for hot flushes and anxiety.
You know, those are the main ones, aren't they? But it's looking at your diet as a whole. So I know that, you know, there's certain things that, you know, it's like that classic, you have a cup of coffee before bed, you're not going to sleep.
Yeah.
There's some people that can have a cup of coffee before bed and sleep much more soundly than if they didn't have a cup of coffee. I mean, I find those people amazing, but you know, it's looking at what works for you. It's individualized. Yeah. You know, some people can have that glass of wine and feel absolutely fine, but actually you find as you get older, your ability to process things like sugar and alcohol get much reduced. And so you're much more likely to have the sort of, in inverted commas, toxic effect from them than when you were younger. So, you know, taking HRT isn't going to be the magic bullet if you're not looking after your health in other ways.
Yeah, I think actually it's also saying, right, you know, you can't do everything in one go. It's taking one small thing and saying, right, actually, I'm going to try and just reduce my sugar intake a little bit this week. You know, maybe it's just one day I try not to try to avoid, or I, you know, I don't have sugar after 12, whatever it might be. But also not trying to do this kind of magic fix when it comes to what you eat and drink in one go, because that's just, you know, that will put your body under stress as well. And we know that dieting, as it were, doesn't work, because it puts this body under stress, and it's not helpful in perimenopause and postmenopause. But just making sure you start small and just begin to become aware of potential triggers as well for your symptoms.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, so if we've spoken about kind of the lifestyle changes that you can make and exercise, I think it's worth mentioning sort of psychological therapies that can really help if you don't want to go down a medical route for your menopausal symptoms. And one of the things that I think is really, really helpful is cognitive behavioral therapy, where you're sort of almost retraining the brain to think about things in a different way, to try and either prevent something happening that might spiral out of control, or at least deal with it if it does happen. So the classic one is if you've had a hot flush, or you're about to get a hot flush and you feel it coming on, and you're in a situation where that's going to be tricky to manage, it's sort of immediately thinking, well, this is, for example, this is a hot flush. It's not going to kill me. I'm going to feel terrible for a few moments, but actually then it's going to be over, and that's it. You know, and that's a very simplistic way of looking at it, I know, but CBT has been shown to be really helpful for those, for some symptoms, not all symptoms. And bear in mind, all these alternative treatments that we're discussing help individual symptoms rather than trying to help everything all together. It's about managing individual symptoms here.
I was just going to say what you just described there is there's a little bit of acceptance as well, isn't there? There's a, you know, kind of if we are resistant to this particular change or this period in our life, that can actually make symptoms worse. But that element, you know, you describe a hot flush. And so becoming aware of it, you know, naming it, going, okay, this is what it is, and basically allowing it to kind of almost like pass through. Sometimes visualizations can help. I know I often teach you visualizations where you're going to jump into a cold pool or a river, a stream or something like that. And so that actually, you take a breath and go to that place. So as it rises and kind of hopefully basically dissipates and disappears, like you say, rather than going, ah, this is stressful, I'm, you know, I'm getting a hot flush with it, especially if it's in a, you know, in a scenario like a work meeting. I've got a friend that's happened to quite a few times, and you know, you just get stressed about it, and actually that makes it worse and lasts longer.
And then moving on to some of the other things that can help, we mentioned acupuncture. That has got a good evidence base behind it. You know, there's a lot of evidence behind things like mindfulness and meditation and just taking time to just really rebalance and ground yourself when you can, even if that's 5 minutes a day. I do that when I get into work before a really long day. I put on my meditation music, turn all my lights off, and just have 5 minutes. And that's really helpful. And then moving on to medical therapies, there are lots and lots of medical therapies that are out there that can really, really help with symptoms. Now, some of them are things like antidepressants, which many, many people will balk at. But actually, when we think about them in the menopause, we're not using them as antidepressants as such. We're using them for their, if you like, their side effect profile. So we're using them because we know that some of them can help with hot flushes, some of them can help with sleep. So actually, there are lots of treatments out there, and I'm not going to go through each individual one now, because obviously this radio show is going out across the world, and you know, those treatments will differ. But do speak to your healthcare professional, because the medications out there are probably going to be quite similar around the world, but they can be used to be really helpful. And then obviously HRT is on the back of that, all of that as well.
We're going to pause there and just take a break to listen to a message from our sponsors.
UK Health Radio, the station that makes you feel good. The station that makes you feel good.
So we were just going through and discussing some of the alternatives or possibilities if you didn't want to take HRT. And actually, I was just going to mention exercise and weight-bearing exercise, Claire, actually something we didn't talk about so much. So, you know, things like brisk walking quite fast. Yeah. I'm not a runner. You are, aren't you? You love your running. And so I tend to walk fast, but even, you know, things like yoga, a lot of the shapes that we come into in yoga are weight bearing, things like downward dog or plank. But also if you quite like lifting weights, that can be really helpful. And this is to ensure bone health, isn't it?
Yeah, actually, it's a really good point, because we know that HRT will help with bone health, heart health and brain health. And that's when we're thinking about more kind of long-term health implications of the menopause. But some of these alternative treatments that we've discussed, whilst they might treat some of the symptoms, they don't always provide the ongoing long-term health benefits that HRT does. So it's really important that if you're not taking HRT, that you're thinking about protecting your bone health. And that goes hand in hand with the diet, and weight-bearing exercise increases bone density as you get older. And we know that past the age of 30 to 40, your bone mass massively decreases, and that's in part because of lack of estrogen. So what we want to do is we want to stop you getting osteoporosis. And that's really not only about diet and lifestyle, but it's about kind of exercise in a big way.
Which brings me on to vitamin D, because actually one of the questions here from Charlotte was what supplements should we be taking? And actually, we generally say not really any, because ideally you're getting what you need from your diet. But vitamin D in particular is one that we would definitely recommend, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I think every woman should be on a good dose of vitamin D, based on whatever your recommended daily allowances are for wherever you are. But certainly, I think perimenopausal and menopausal women should be on a daily supplement. Now, that can be in a multivitamin, but often in a multivitamin, the doses are lower. I mean, I know that for me, I take a vitamin D supplement every day, and in part that's because I'm celiac, so I have a tendency to have not to not absorb. I don't take a lot of calcium in my diet because I'm not a massive fan of dairy. I just don't like the taste, so I have to take that in an alternative form. And because I'm celiac, I'm at a greater risk of low bone density anyway, and so I take a good dose of vitamin D. But it is really important because it will also help with your bone health as well.
And we should explain that vitamin D helps the absorption of calcium, doesn't it? Protecting our bones. So, and magnesium is another one that comes up that many women mention that helps joint pain, muscle pain, sleep. But actually, you can get quite a lot from magnesium from nuts and seeds.
Nuts and seeds are also, they're hugely beneficial in terms of just not only just the magnesium, but the B vitamins as well. You know, all of this is dietary, really. You can get a lot of it in your diet.
Things like phytoestrogens are often mentioned as well, which are the kind of, I guess, natural plant form of estrogen. And they can help, can't they?
They can help. There's a lot of natural remedies out there, and you know, there's hundreds and hundreds of different types of natural remedies. And whilst the majority of them are safe, I guess it's worth just bearing in mind what you're spending your money on, because I don't want women to be spending ridiculous sums of money on supplements if they don't need to. And actually, they aren't necessarily evidence-based or licensed products, but they are sold. And so I just kind of caveat that with a warning of, you know, I'm not going to mention them all here because I mean, there's hundreds of different types, but actually just be careful what you're buying and make sure it's from a reputable source.
Another question here from Jenny, and she was asking about hair loss. She's not on HRT and noticing hair loss and hair thinning. And this is another really common one through perimenopause, isn't it, and postmenopause as well.
It really is. And hair thinning in the menopause is really complicated because our hair growth cycle is quite long and can be affected by so many different aspects, but also estrogen deficiency. And female pattern hair loss is really common, increases with age, and although it occurs at various stages of life, typically at times of stress or during pregnancy or after birth, it's really common around the perimenopause and menopause. And I think it's something somewhere I read that's up to 40% of women will experience this at the perimenopause or menopause, but to a varying degree. And I think in part it's estrogen related, but also I also think that there's going to, I mean, there's evidence that emerging that it's significantly related to our fall in testosterone levels as well as we get older and as we go through the perimenopause. It's a hard one to treat. It's a hard one to treat.
And I think it's worth mentioning we've got Dr. Esdale, a consultant dermatologist, lined up, haven't we, in a few weeks? So we'll make sure we cover that with him as well and get a little bit more detail around what can potentially help. Another question here from Emma, and this is quite this will be specific actually to your expertise, Claire. How often should you be monitored when starting estrogen gel if you have an existing fibroid?
Yeah, so this is a good question. It would depend on if you're so it depends on your the dose of your hormone replacement therapy. We know that fibroid growth is related to the level of estrogen in your blood. So providing you are but also it's worth knowing that HRT and estradiol is delivering tiny, tiny doses of estrogen far lower than you would have produced in a natural cycle. So whilst there may be some increase in growth in your fibroid whilst on HRT, we don't think that that growth is huge. So really, the monitoring is about making sure your HRT doses are all fine and your symptoms are settling. So, you know, on starting 3 months later and then annually thereafter. And then if there's anything in between that happens, so for example, if you get any abnormal vaginal bleeding, if you're just not feeling quite right, then I'd always say, you know, you have to go and see someone and speak to someone about that. You don't necessarily need routine scans at any particular time interval. It really depends on what you're experiencing. So again, really individualised.
Thank you for that. One more question from Catherine, asking about red skin. So I'm a huge assumption here, but I'm going to say it's likely to be rosacea. And once again, it's I know a lot of women suffer with this as they come through perimenopause and menopause. And alcohol and caffeine can be a trigger, actually. I know myself that if I have a couple of glasses of wine, I can feel my cheeks getting a bit red. So it is worth speaking to your GP about it. Is there anything as a GP you could recommend or prescribe as a GP? Is it something that you deal with?
Yeah, I think it's really common in the perimenopause, and certainly the menopause, from fluctuating levels of oestrogen. And it kind of links back to that dry, itchy skin that you get as one of the symptoms, and also related to hot flushes as well. So, you know, when our blood vessels dilate a bit during a hot flush, and when so there's an increase in blood flow to the skin, it can give you that red skin. I mean, I have to say that the mainstay of treatment is really good skincare. I mean, nothing fancy. It doesn't need to be fancy, but it's just making sure that you're looking after your skin and not exposing it to sort of too many harsh chemicals. You're thinking back to the basics, really, and also considering HRT as an option as well. It wouldn't be obviously a first line go to if that was your only symptom necessarily, but it's worth a thought.
Yeah, and I think actually it's often at this time around perimenopause that skin sensitivities perhaps begin to creep in where you didn't think you had sensitivities before. So, you know, if you are somebody who likes to look after their skin. I've got way too many skincare products, but actually thinking very much about sensitive ranges and bearing in mind, actually, you know, just a regular soap has got a very, very different pH to a facial cleanser. So it's not that you have to spend a lot of money on a facial cleanser, but actually I know some of the kind of just regular soaps, like, you know, Johnson's baby soap, for example, has got a pH of about 11 or 12, I think, and actually our skin pH is normally somewhere between 4.5 and 5.5. Mm-hmm. So thinking about what, you know, what harsh soaps you're using on your skin, if you are. There's a great analogy, and I can't remember who I would cite this to, because I'm not sure where I read it, but it was if you imagine you're washing up a greasy frying pan with, you know, strong washing up liquid, the job of that washing up liquid is to cut through the oil and the grease and make sure you kind of remove it. And actually, so with the harsher soaps, that's what you're doing, and you want that protective layer of on your skin. It's basically the sebum. You need it to protect your skin, and you don't want to get rid of it, because that's when it's going to become more prone to things like perhaps rosacea and people become more sensitive.
We you know, when women do have these skin issues during the perimenopause, I often suggest using emollient creams, emollient moisturizers, so those that you perhaps kind of use in people with eczema to wash with. And although they don't lather like a soap, you can stick them on a cotton wool pad and just moisturize your face and clean your face that way. There's also lots of evidence to suggest that testosterone therapy, and whilst that's not widely available, I know, can increase sebum production in the skin. And so actually, if you're increasing sebum production in the skin, that's probably going to be a good thing overall.
Yeah. And actually, it's interesting you talk about the emollients as a sort of cleanser. I mean, you could almost apply it, which is what I tend to do. I use a cream or oil cleanser. And if you gently massage it into the skin, you can then take it off with a warm face cloth and make sure it's not hot, because that's going to make any redness worse. But actually, you can do it that way as well. So, yeah, a little bit of self-care for skin, but definitely worth speaking to a GP initially about the concerns as well. We're going to take another break and listen to a message from our sponsors.
UK Health Radio, the station that makes you feel good. The station that makes you feel good.
You're listening to UK Health Radio with myself, Caroline, and Dr. Claire, the Menopause Sisters.
We're doing a bit of a Q&A today, aren't we, Caroline? Just some of the questions that have come into us over the last couple of weeks. And one of the ones we were about to discuss was a lady called Jane, who had emailed into us and said, if I have Mirena coil in and I've stopped having my periods, how will I know if I'm perimenopausal or menopausal? And that's a really good question. We get asked that a lot. And what I think it's worth remembering is that you don't necessarily have to have a change in your periods to be perimenopausal. Now, we know that the Mirena coil, the hormonal coil, will actually probably stop periods completely in most women. So you can't rely on any period changing as part of your perimenopausal symptoms. But what you can do is you can keep your symptoms tracker and score sheet. And so you can track your symptoms from month to month and see if there's anything emerging that are new to you. So whilst you can't rely on your periods, you could think about those other symptoms that we've discussed, you know, in the past. So things like your physical symptoms, hot flushes, night sweats, dry eyes, dry skin, bowel problems, joint pains, you know, the list is endless. But you kind of have to have a look at all your symptoms collectively and not just rely on your periods. And actually, if you have a look at our Instagram feed and have a look at some of those symptoms that are listed there, you could start tracking your symptoms and see what's going on for you.
Yeah, our Instagram feed is The Menopause Sisters, and it's the same on Facebook as well. Another question that came in, or that popped up actually, from somebody called Susie, and it was something I wasn't completely sure about when I first got my prescription of HRT a couple of months ago. So she's pleased, you know, she's got her oestrogestin, she's got some oestrogen gel, she's been prescribed 2 pumps of the oestrogen gel and 2 capsules of the oestrogestin each night on days 15 to 26 of her cycle. However, because her cycle's all over the place and she's currently waiting for her periods about 2 weeks late, she's not sure where to start the gel now or when to take the progesterone. And so what would your advice be if that was the case?
You'll soon get into a routine with it. I mean, if you're perimenopausal and your periods are all over the place, it's impossible to know when to start. I would start the gel and then 2 weeks later start the progesterone, purely because and it's easier in a way, rather than remembering it's day 15 to 26, I just say 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off. So 2 weeks on your gel, then you start your eutrogestin, 2 weeks on the eutrogestin and the gel, and then the eutrogestin stops. So I think if you don't know where you are in your cycle, then it's completely fine to start the gel and get the treatment started as quickly as possible. Obviously, if you can time it a bit better and you know when your periods are, then obviously start on day 15 if your cycle of day one is the first day of your period.
That's kind of our main questions. Was there anything you wanted to add actually to our sort of Q&A, or anything that you wanted to share that we haven't talked about today?
No, I had one last question about bleeding on HRT, which is probably a good one to mention briefly. And whilst any bleeding, probably you should speak to your healthcare professional, it is worth just noting that when you first start HRT, having some bleeding is normal, whether or not you're on a regime that doesn't give you bleeding or not. Sometimes it's quite normal to experience some irregular bleeding in the first few months of taking it. But if it prolongs, or if it's worrying, or you're just, you know, if you're worried about it, speak to a health professional. But I would say generally that can be a normal side effect. It should settle down.
Which has reminded me actually of something that I'd seen recently. Potentially progesterone can cause breast tenderness. Is that right?
I mean, estrogen can, to be fair, as well, but progesterone is the thing that can cause a lot of breast tenderness as well. But yeah, that should settle. And a really good treatment for that is to be taking evening primrose oil or starflower oil. That can be really helpful to alleviate breast tenderness.
I think it's worth mentioning that if you've decided to go down the HRT route, you know, you're looking at sort of 3 to 6 months as you tweak it and your body gets used to having those hormones back, actually, isn't it? It's just that it's not going to be a quick fix. Although I know after about 2 weeks, I just felt like I had a little bit more energy, my mood had lifted, and I hadn't considered I had a low mood at all, but I just felt a bit, I had a spring in my step, I might say.
Yeah.
But actually, you know, it can take a bit of time to settle and actually to work out if you've got the right dose and the right combination.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's good to chat with all those questions. We will be back next week with another show and another guest. Thank you for joining us. And if you do have any questions, do please message us via our Instagram and Facebook pages at The Menopause Sisters, or you can reach us at hello@themenopausesisters.com. And whilst we can't give personalised, individualised advice, we can definitely talk around your question and perhaps help or guide you into what might be useful, but also give you references as well. And we'll do another Q&A perhaps in the new year, because we often get questions and it's quite nice to bring them together. Sometimes that we get so entrenched in this topic that we don't realise what, or we forget, I should say, what it's like not to know as much.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's quite a nice way to address some of the myths as well, and maybe just sort of do let us know, like Caroline said, if you've got anything, so that we can explain.
I'll see you again next week. Look forward to seeing you then.
Lovely. Take care.